If you would turn with me to book my host to Isaiah chapter number one. Isaiah chapter number one. And we'll be looking at verse number 18.
If I could this morning, I want to look at red, white, and blue. Red, white, and blue. Isaiah chapter number one, verse number 18. Isaiah writes and he says, as a prophet of the Lord, come now and let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Amen. We probably have never lived in more dangerous times than what we live in right now. You know, we live in a very sinister world. We live in a world where there are many hidden dangers. Amen. And no one really knows what lies completely ahead of us. Amen. We are really in times of national crisis and distress. But one thing that we found that when we're in those times of national crisis and distress, America really rallies together, don't they? Amen. Really rallies together. How many of you remember that September 11th attack? And how that people came together, and when you did see the flag, how that it was amazing to watch that flag fly and what that means to us. Let me grab my candle here. I marked this. I want us to kind of think a little bit about our flag this morning and what our flag represents and means. The Star Spangled Banner says this: Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming? Whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, or the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare and the bombs bursting in air gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave? Oh, thus be it ever when free men shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation. Blessed with victory and peace, may the heaven's rescued land praise the power that hath made and preserved us a nation. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave? Let me give you a little bit of American trivia here. Who was that person who sewed the first American flag? Betsy Ross. And so Betsy Ross, as she sewed together that first flag for the United States of America, do you know that she was married a total of three times, and not because she didn't get along with her first two husbands, but because her first two husbands were killed in a war? Interesting. Here it was that in 1860, let me take you back a little bit. Bear with me, we are getting somewhere, but let me give you a little bit of American history that is good this morning. In 1860, there was a man by the name of Andrew Griscom, who migrated from England into New York. And Andrew Griscom, he became friends with one of his fellow Quakers by the name of William Penn. Does anyone ever hear that name, William Penn, before? Probably all of us, because of Pennsylvania history, has heard that name. But William Penn, he himself was a man who hired Andrew Griscom to become a carpenter. And Andrew Griscom began to build a city called Philadelphia. Any of you heard of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania before? So here it was that Andrew Griscom builds Philadelphia, and then he has a son named Andrew Griscom who follows after his father's footprints, and he is a carpenter as well, and he works on building a building called Independence Hall. And Andrew Griscom has a daughter and names her Betsy Griscom. Well, Betsy Griscom was one of 18 children. Can you imagine having 18 children? And so one of 18 children, and her parents, very faithful Quaker members, loved God, Protestant people who loved God. They believed in the equality of education for all. And so in raising their children, they believed that their daughter deserved as much of an education as their son deserved. And so they sent her to school, and she was trained to be a seamstress in the middle of her education. They sent her to work in an upholstery shop. It was a sewing and an upholstery shop. And there, Betsy Griscom learned all the details of sewing and became a very good sewer. She was there with another apprentice, a young man by the name of John Ross. John Ross was not a Quaker, but he was a Presbyterian. And all of a sudden, and they're working together, here it was that Betsy Griscom fell in love with John Ross. Her parents did not like the idea of her dating someone outside of her denomination. In fact, she would become later shunned by her denomination. But one night, they sat across the Delaware River, and they got married in New Jersey. And there was, shunned by her family, she began to go to Christ Church. And Christ Church, the pew that they sat on was just a few pews away from another man who would come and do his work and his business there in Philadelphia area. Maybe you've not heard his name before, but his name was George Washington. You hear of him before? Have you? A couple up there. If you haven't, he was the first president of the United States. And so it was during the war that George Washington approached this young Betsy Ross and asked her if she would be willing to make a flag that would represent the United States of America. They brought the design to her, and when they brought the design to her, Betsy Ross tweaked that. It was there that, during the war that her husband was guarding an ammunition area where there was a black powder and ammunition kept, and somehow it caught on fire, and John Ross became wounded. Betsy rushed to his side to take care of him, but the wounds proved to be fatal, and he died. Betsy continued to keep their business of sewing going on. And it was sometime later that she met another young man. She was actually did not have children. She was in her early 20s. She was 21 when she married John Ross. And again, she met a man in 1777 that she fell in love with. His name was Ashburn. Joseph Ashburn was his name. And he was taken by the British Army captive and taken to England. And he was charged with treason. And there he died in prison. However, there was another man that was in prison with Joseph Ashford by the name of John Claypool, and he brought a letter back to Betsy from her second husband who had died. And you know what happened? All of a sudden, over the course of time, Betsy fell in love with John Claypool, and they got married. Betsy, being one of 18 children, only 9 of them living to be to make it to adulthood, there she developed the flag for the United States of America. It wasn't until Congress began to create the seal for the United States of America using those same colors, red, white, and blue, that they disclosed to the American people what the colors represented. And that Continental Congress, they said that the colors white represented purity and innocence, red represented valor and hardiness, and blue represents a vigilance, and it represents justice and valor. And so those were the colors that was given. On that first flag, there was only 13 stars that was there. In fact, when the stars were being developed, Betsy gave them a better outline and design of what the stars should look like. If you count those stars, there are 50 now that represents each one of our states united in the United States of America. Originally, it was 13, the 13 colonies. If you count the white and the red, you will find that there are 13 stripes that represents the original 13 colonies there from England that came to the United States to find their independence and be able to worship God independently. How awesome. What a great story. But could I take this morning, for the next few moments, could we just look at those colors of what really I believe that if we would give them spiritual significance this morning of what they mean to us in our independence as a Christian. I don't want to upset anyone's apple cart this morning, but once again, I'm thankful for America. The older I get, the more I realize. My mom would take it for granted. My mom noticed yesterday. It's good to have her here with us, by the way. She noticed all lining down the streets in Halifax and Lycans, all the signs that families have placed with their loved ones, whether deceased or still living, still they place them on those flags, and they give their years of service and their name. I'm thankful for America, and I'm thankful for those who gave their life. Amen. Whether it was time that they gave in their life or whether they gave all and sacrificed their life for what we have this morning. We're able to come and we're able to worship because of them giving and their fighting. Thank God for America. Thank God for men and women that still thinks freedom's worth fighting for. Amen. Thank God for that. And then I want to look at, first of all, the red. I know that when we look at it, that the Continental Congress said this, that represents valor and hardiness. But for us as believers, I need to say that it not only represents that, it represents the bloodshed by those who died for our country. But thank God for the liberty this morning that is found in the cross of Jesus Christ. Can't believe I didn't get an amen on that. I said, thank God for the liberty that is found in the cross of Jesus Christ. Amen. You look at the cross, and it's an emblem that we have on our sanctuary this morning. Amen. It's an emblem that is not bloodstained, but if I could take you to the cross of Calvary over 2,000 years ago, there was a man that was whipped and marred and beaten beyond all recognition. There was a bloodstain upon the cross. It flowed down the cross. It fell upon the ground. Can you imagine what the ground, Brother Terry, it would begin to speak out, amen, as the blood of Jesus Christ fell upon the physical ground, amen, of this earth that we live on. The blood of one that was spotless, the blood of one that was pure, amen, the blood of Jesus Christ, amen, where all prodigals find their way back home, amen. I was once a prodigal. Many or most, if not all of you, were once a prodigal, but the blood of Jesus Christ gave us liberty, gave us a pass to come back home. We're no longer eating in a pig pen. We're no longer living in a faraway country, separated from the Father. Amen. But the blood of Jesus Christ has given us liberty to be able to come back to our Heavenly Father and have a relationship with Him. Amen. We can commune with Him. We can talk with Him. We can experience His love. We can live in His home. Amen. Where He provides provisions for us because He loves us this morning. Thank God for the red. Thank God for the blood. Yeah. Hallelujah, the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. The Word of God says that we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Amen. But the blood of Jesus Christ, it washes us, it reconciles us, it brings us to where we need to be to find liberty this morning. In the book of Romans, chapter number 5, if you would this morning. Romans chapter number 5, starting at verse number 6. The Bible says, For when we were yet without strength. Do you know what the writer here, Paul, was saying? He was saying, when you and I were without salvation. The Bible says, in due time, at God's appointed time, Christ died for the ungodly. Amen. The blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. God searched through all of heaven and all of earth, and He couldn't find one in earth, and the only one He could find in heaven was His very own Son. So He said, Son, would you go and would you give your life as a sacrifice that I may save all of humanity? And the Son said, I will do the Father's will, and I will go, and not my will, but your will be done. I will take upon myself flesh, and I will allow my flesh, amen, to experience the sins of all the world so that they may experience forgiveness.
Amen.
The Word of God says, for scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Amen. And there's not many that would die for someone else. Yet peradventure for a good man, some would even dare to die. Would you give your life for someone you didn't know? Would you give your life to someone who, for someone who did you wrong, came against you? But the Word of God says, Jesus did that. Verse number 8, but God commendeth His love toward us, in that while we were yet a sinner, Christ died for us. God loves us this morning. He sent His only begotten Son. Amen. He gave His life's blood for you and I, that we may have liberty this morning. Amen. We're not bound by sin, but we live in a liberty where we're free from sin this morning because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Not only red, but we think of the white. The verse I read this morning in Isaiah chapter 1, verse number 18, the Word of God says, though your sins are red, are like the scarlet, or dark, dirty, they shall be as white as snow. Let me talk to you for a moment. Now I know that we are in July and it is hot. But it's not been that many months ago that we were fighting some snow. I remember one particular snowstorm on a Wednesday where I left the hospital. And I wish I would have never went to the hospital to work that day, Brother David. And I remember you texting me, saying, you better get home. It was snowy and it was crazy, Terry. It was unbelievable. And we are blessed to live in this area, Brother Josh. As much as the roads may be bad, Sister Jenny, she's saying, thank God I'm retired. And Walmart don't even close for snow, does it, Sister Susan? Not too often, anyway. But we are still blessed to live in this area where we can look at the majesty of the mountains, Brother Dennis, and we can see the snow. But do you realize that beneath the snow, there are some things? There are some mud that's there beneath the snow. There are some dead trees and wood, Brother Bobby. There are some dead animals that's beneath that snow. But when you go out on a beautiful snow-covered day, and it is beautiful, and you look, you don't see the dead stuff that's beneath. You don't see the dirt that is beneath. You don't see all the bad stuff that is beneath there. But you go out, and Brother Wally, you might even have to break open your sunglasses and put them on your face, because you look at all around you, there is white. Amen. And it's so bright and beautiful and clean and glistening. Amen. That it almost hurts your eyes, Sister Jane. It's so beautiful. The dirt and the grime and the deadness just simply cannot be seen. And that's exactly what happens. Amen. With the white. Amen. Jesus said, I will wash you with my blood, and all the deadness you were once dead in your sins, the Word of God says, all the things that you're ashamed of, all the dirt and all the mud and all the grime, God white as wool. I'm going to take care of all that dirt. I don't see it when I look down. All I see is the cleanness and the purity that the blood of Jesus Christ has washed it all away. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Amen. There is nothing, 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 the songwriter writes, that can take away my sins. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. God sees it white. He doesn't see death. You're not bound by sin and the death that is entangled with sin, but He sees the whiteness and the beauty. Amen. Amen. How many of you know what I'm talking about? The blood of Jesus Christ has washed you. Amen. Your life, when God looks at it, it's as white as the new driven snow. We think about independence this morning. We think about red, white, and blue, and thank God for our country, what all that represents. But thank God that He washes us with His blood, Brother Josh, and He cleanses and makes us with the snow of the grave. Those are the things we've experienced. But the blue is the hope of what we will experience. One day, we're going to go to heaven. The blue represents eternity in heaven. In Romans 6, verse number 23, the Word of God says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Red, white, and blue represents that we have freedom and we have life and we have liberty. Brother Dennis, blue because we have the promise of heaven. A true story is given of a man named George Ritchie, who in December 1943, he was part of basic training. He seemed to be doing well, and he caught what he thought was a chest cold, Sister Rachel, and all of a sudden he collapsed, and the doctor was called, and military, the doctor declared him dead. Sister Beth, they assigned a particular soldier, Brother Caleb, to come and take care of his body. And the soldier noticed that there was a twinge, that there was a twitch to George Ritchie's body. And so he called the doctor, and the doctor took epinephrine. He took it. He injected right in George's heart some adrenaline. And all of a sudden, his heart started beating, and he made a full recovery. And he went on later to be a doctor himself. But he shared that when in that moment where he died, he said he saw his body, he saw himself leaving his body and traveling a great city, the distance to a huge city. And what a city it was. It was a city that was built on light, a city who within its walls there was houses and there were streets that seemed to give off light. And right in the middle, there was one who radiated light. And he said, all of a sudden, during his Christian walk, he said he got into the book of Revelation, and he began to read and recognize that he had died and he had went to heaven, where there was Jesus, who was the giver of life and the giver of light. And when he had died, all the light just radiated throughout that city. That is the hope that we have, that someday, because of the blood of Jesus Christ and because of the confession of our sins and the acceptance of Him coming in and washing us as new, white as a new driven snow, that someday we will go to heaven as well, where there is complete life and where there is complete liberty. Thank God this morning for red, white, and blue. There in the Twin Towers, September 11, 2001, when the first plane hit the building, throughout the World Trade Centers across the intercom were the words, "The building is secure. Return to your offices." Some did not take heed to the message they got for that. Others found their death because of the message. It wasn't because they meant to do harm or evil. It was what they felt was right to do and to bring some calm to a lot of chaos. The building is secure. Return to your office. Only to find out it was not secure. I'm going to tell you this morning,
Sister Holly comes to the piano. The only security that we have this morning is found in Jesus Christ. The world can call out with a lot of things. Build your bank account. Build your retirement. Take care of your body. Get education. Live for the moment. All these securities. But I can tell you, all false glories. The real red, white, and blue that brings real freedom and liberty is only found in the blood of Jesus. Amen, saints of God. That's where our life, and that's where our liberty, and that's where our freedom is, in the blood of Jesus. Because when we accept the work of the cross, and we accept the blood of Jesus, He washes us white as snow. One of the things I like least about my sister Jane is when it is gloomy and everything is dark and muddy and no vibrance of life and color. I really like when there is a beautiful snowfall that hangs on the trees and covers everything. I'm not saying I like shoveling and dropping it. I'm just simply saying I like the beauty of it. See, without Jesus, the blood of Jesus, we just have a bunch of dead stuff laying around, don't you know? But when we ask the blood of Jesus to wash us and to cleanse us, He covers the deadness and shows the beauty of who He is. And He gives us promise and hope. This morning, with every head bowed and every eye closed, and every eye open. Before I go any further, would there be someone this morning that would say, Pastor Saville, I don't know Jesus as my Savior. I feel like my life is a forest that's dead, full of dead leaves and dead trees that's fallen and dead animals, that it's muddy and it's unbeautiful. That's my life. But this morning, I'd like to accept the blood of Jesus Christ by faith into my life. Now I'm going to cover me with this white snow. Is there anyone here that says that's me? I want to give my heart to Jesus. Anyone? If you are able, would you stand this morning? Amen. I'm going to ask Sister Holly to sing this. These altars are always open. But would you this morning, would you make an altar in your heart? And would you bow your heart before God? And as we sing this, would you just lift up your hands before God? And would you say, God, thank you for red, white, and blue. Thank you for the blood that washed me. Thank you for the deadness and the mud that is covered. And thank you for the hope of heaven this morning. Amen. Let's sing it together.
Jesus.
I'm here.
Amen. Aren't you glad for the blood of Jesus? Amen. He said, come now and let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they are dark and marring you. Amen. Let us reason together. Amen. Because of his blood, they shall be washed, covered as white as snow. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for freedom. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, we love you this morning. Thank you for the liberty that's found in your spirit this morning. Thank you for freedom. Amen. Thank you that we have been washed as white as the new driven snow. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Let's pray together this morning. Hallelujah. Father, I love you and I'm thankful for your faithfulness. God, I thank you for the United States of America. God, this morning I pray for our president and vice president. God, I pray for our leaders, God, in government, in our state, on a state level, and God, on a local level, I pray that you would lead them. God, I pray that your presence would invade every encounter when they begin to make laws, God, and they begin to discuss, God, the details of the people of the United States of America. God, I pray that you would be in charge. God, that you would turn the hearts of every leader to you. God, that you would restore our nation back to a place, God, where we fall upon our knees and our face before you, and we seek you for revival, God. We seek you for direction in our life. God, I pray that you would be with our church this morning, God, that we would be a lighthouse set on the hill here in Lycans, God, that we would show this community that we live in life and in liberty because, God, we've been washed by the blood of you. God, we are no longer living in deadness and barrenness, but, God, when you look at us, God, you see nothing but purity and whiteness that comes from the blood of Jesus Christ. God, I pray that in our homes and in our lives daily, God, that we would live with the hope of knowing one day we are going to see you face to face, God. Lord, that we would live in liberty so that someday when you judge, God, we'll be able to stand in freedom and in liberty of spending an eternity with you. Thank you, Father, for what you've done in our country. But thank you, Father, more for what you've done in our lives as believers. God, may we stand in the independence that you've given us. Thank you. We were once prodigal, but we've been brought back into the Father's home. God, where there is freedom and liberty to have a relationship with the Father. May we live in the freedom and liberty of relationship with you this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Shake hands. Amen. Let your brothers and sisters know how much you love and appreciate them this morning.